Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. This is a virtual meeting. And the first item on our agenda is consideration of subordinate legislation, the Education Miscellaneous Amendments Coronavirus Scotland No. 2 Regulations 2021. The regulations are being considered under the negative procedure. Do members have any comments on the instrument? There are no members who wish to make any comment on the instrument. Is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to the instrument? Are we agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. We'll now move on to the second agenda item for our meeting, which is an evidence session looking at how schools are coping with the start of term in the context of the high numbers of COVID cases as a result of the Omicron variant. And to that end, the committee warmly welcomes Douglas Hutchison, President of the Association of Directors of Education and Education Director of Education, Glasgow City Council. Good morning, Douglas. I see you there. Greg Dempster, the General Secretary of the Association of Head Teachers and Deputies of Scotland. Good morning, Greg. Simon Cameron, Chief Officer Employers Team at the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, COSLA. Same to you, Simon. And we also welcome Margaret Wilson, who is Chair of the National Parent Forum of Scotland. Good morning to all of you. Thank you for giving up your time to be with us and to help us with this session, which is, as I said earlier, is focused on what has happened at the start of this term. If I may start the questioning, to COSLA in particular. I'm addressing this question primarily to Simon, but others may come in and comment if they wish. Your written submission to us today for this session today talks about how the budget has been baselined for additional teachers and how individuals will be employed on permanent or temporary contracts as appropriate to the role and identified needs of services. Can you just talk me through, Simon, how your members will make decisions about whether a contract should be permanent or temporary? Simon?
Hi there, thanks, convener.
Hi, yes. Simon.
Sorry, can you hear me now? Apologies.
Yes, I can. And see you as well. Good. Did you get the drift of my question about contracts?
How people will work through making people temporary or permanent.
But yes, also, there
will be at play in terms of the requirements of children, young people in the learning that's required, but also in terms of obviously the numbers that are associated in a school of young people who are there. Obviously, from individual councils' points of view, actually there are a large number of active permanent posts across the country. One of the challenges we do face is often that actually trying to take permanent posts in across the country, particularly when you get to rural areas and so forth, we don't get quite the level of applications for these roles. But in terms of going through a productive process in terms of understanding what's a permanent and a temporary contract, it will be based on all of the local factors in relation to the school role, the requirements of the children and young people there, the needs that they have in terms of their learning, whether it be additional support need, learning that need, whether that be a teaching requirement, whether that be a support assistant requirement that's involved there. It'll also be to do with factors such as those who are already on staff, those who may be retiring, and indeed what you would call in any organisation a natural wastage of individuals who maybe move on and leave and go to other roles as well. It will also be in terms of individuals' progressions. So a broad range of factors that are any factors that would be involved in employment across any field for a large-scale organisation to consider what is the most appropriate contract for an individual to be on. Now, clearly, what we can't do is offer people permanent contracts where there is not a permanency required. So that's where the decision would be made, whether it would be a temporary long-term, short-term, or indeed, if there is a permanent requirement, they would make a permanent appointment to that. But a broad range of factors would go into deciding what's appropriate for each individual establishment. We'd also be down to factors such as what type of process do the council have in place. Some have different setups where they would have what you may call area cover, so they would have pools of staff, etc. So yet again, it's about the intake and, you know, natural usage, succession, etc. that would be involved in any process.
The reason I want to get to the bottom of this is because, I mean, obviously the morale of teachers is a very important consideration for all of us. Teachers, inspirational teachers, are exactly what we need in all of our classrooms across Scotland at all levels of education. The Cabinet Secretary, when the announcement was made about the baseline money being consolidated, made permanent, seemed to suggest that there was some form of an agreement between the Scottish Government and COSLA that that money would be used to recruit teachers or cement teachers on permanent contracts. Is that right? Was there an agreement between the Scottish Government and COSLA that the money would be used in that way?
There was an agreement that the money would be used to make sure that the appropriate levels of staff were in the appropriate places across the country. So, you know, in terms of the money being baselined, obviously any organisation, whether it be for teaching or any other type of role that we've got, would go through the process, I suppose, that I've described to see what are the requirements of that organisation, how do we bring people and how do we place them in the correct place. Obviously,
was it understood by COSLA that the Scottish Government was giving this money to the local authorities for these contracts to be made permanent? Was that implicit in the discussions between the Scottish Government and COSLA?
It was understood that the money would be given so that we could put in place the appropriate employment contracts for individuals across the country, and that would include permanent, but it would also include temporary. As I say, it has to be a process that you work through properly, so that actually, in terms of employment law and the rest, we've got people on the right types of contracts that are being taken.
Has COSLA or its individual members been asked to provide any kind of report directly on the way this money has been used to make teachers' contracts permanent? Is there a reporting mechanism?
Absolutely, there are reporting mechanisms happening. They happen as a matter of course anyway, but particularly through the COVID experience and the rest, obviously the money that we've been provided by Scottish Government, we have been asked to provide reports. That is something that's actively happening in the rest. Yet again, also part of the process is obviously the money coming through and into the system to then make sure that we can put people onto the appropriate contracts. So that money is there. People are now working through the process. They're doing, and the other side of this is, obviously you need to do a recruitment process. So you need to go through and make sure that the person you're appointing is fit and proper for that role, has got the skills and experience that you require in that area, whether that be subject matter at secondary or obviously the appropriate level at primary as well. So.
Has COSLA issued guidance, Simon Cameron? Has COSLA issued guidance to its members that this money should be used for this purpose and not simply be, as it were, folded into the budget? In other words, it's not being used to compensate for reductions that might occur in other aspects of budgeting.
No, it's very clear, and in terms of the agreement of the money coming into COSLA and the process that we go through, the money going out to councils and the rest, it's very clear that this is for employment purposes and employment purposes only. So that's what people will be using the money for.
And have you personally been involved in any discussions with the Scottish Government about reducing the number of temporary teacher contracts? Because last summer it was 1 in 8. Of our teachers were on temporary contracts. Have you personally or any of your members been involved in discussions with the Scottish Government about reducing that number?
We're involved all the time. We're engaged with Scottish Government in terms of looking at the recruitment that's required across Scotland, and we're actively seeking to make sure that we've got the appropriate numbers of teachers and in the appropriate places across Scotland. Before we hit the pandemic, we had issues of looking at where teachers were applying for posts. We still, throughout the pandemic, not only in teaching but in other areas as well, have that need to make sure that we get people to all parts of Scotland to be able to apply and to then fulfil the roles. So that's an active part of what we continuously do with the Scottish Government.
It's just the level of temporary contracts in Scotland last summer, as I say, was 1 in 8, and that's pretty much double what it was a decade before.
Yeah, and last summer that was on the basis that the money that we had received was temporary. You could not employ somebody in any field unless your money was baseline. The money is now baseline, so we are now actively working through, and councils will be using that money to take people into the appropriate employment contract. However, as I say, I think it's very clear that you still need to go through a fit and proper process for employment, as you would do in any field. And I think anyone in our community would expect that we have done so, and that we've got the right.
Yeah, but there are teachers. There are teachers at work today in classrooms across Scotland who have been on temporary contracts. And the Scottish Government's intent was that this baseline money would translate those temporary contracts where it's appropriate. And I grant you that proviso. But the intention was that these contracts would become permanent. And our committee is very interested to make sure that money, the taxpayers' money, is being used for the purposes that we would all like to see it used for, I think, which would be because we're talking about the well-being of teachers. And let me just ask you one another question in relation to teachers' well-being, because you mentioned that clearly also in your paper to us. And thank you, by the way, for your paper. But you mentioned that in your paper. So do you recognise the issue raised a couple of weeks ago in the Glasgow Evening Times in relation to the number of days lost to mental health issues among teachers? It said since 2017 this figure would amount to 1,500 years of lost teacher days due to mental health issues. What factors do you attribute to this particular issue?
I suppose that there are a great many factors that would be attributable to that situation at this moment in time, and I don't know the article that you're referring to specifically. I've not read it in detail, so I won't be able to comment on it directly. But clearly, across the piece, there are pressures in the system. There have been pressures in our system for a long time because of the levels of funding that we have been receiving, etc. That has undoubtedly led in all fields for people to have increased workloads. We're obviously very actively looking at what we can do to reduce teacher workloads. That's something that we're involved with our trade union colleagues in through the SNCT, and indeed directly involved with our colleagues at Scottish Government as well. I think, you know, obviously we all know what the impact of the pandemic has been on us for a great many different factors, not only work-related but also personal because of what people have been experiencing and the rest. So there undoubtedly has been an increase because of that. Just because of, I think, the natural situation we all find ourselves in terms of being concerned about what might happen should you contract COVID and so forth. Clearly, what we've done throughout the pandemic is make sure that there are supports available to our colleagues in all of the roles that they do, proactively, both at a national level but also at a local level. Local authorities have done an awful lot of work to make sure that the supports are in place for individuals in the roles that they do, that there is, whether it be counselling, whether it be other means, etc., that they can make sure that they are looking after themselves well and able to do their jobs to the best of their ability.
Well, Simon Cameron, let's hear what Greg Dempster has got to say about what you've just said, about how we are responding to the contract situation, which itself is, I think, a stress that teachers probably don't need at these times of all times, and the issue of the mental health and general well-being of our teachers across Scotland. Greg, what are your comments on that? Greg Dempster.
Thanks very much, Convener. In terms of the recruitment point that you were pursuing there around about temporary and permanent contracts, that's not something that members have been coming to me about. We've not been discussing it within the association, so I can't comment on that. I would say that if it had been an issue of particularly heavy concern for my membership, then I would have expected to hear about it. But I know that a lot of the concerns that you've heard have come from class teacher unions rather than ones representing school leaders. Right. In terms of mental health and wellbeing, the figures that you quoted from the Glasgow Evening Times, I've got no frame of reference about whether that's high, low or medium in terms of other periods. It sounds like a big number, and certainly I'm concerned about the pressure and strain that school leaders and my members are under across the country, and have been before the pandemic, but particularly over the last couple of years through this pandemic period. I think a big signal, a recognition of that pressure that school leaders are under, is that the inspectorate were planning to recommence inspection this side of Christmas, and having been out in schools for the first time in a long time, doing some follow-up inspection activity before Christmas, they've stepped back from that. And that says a lot. It's a strong message about the pressure that schools and school leaders are under, and they need to be very careful about the additional pressures that they're faced with. In terms of the supports for wellbeing that Simon talked about, Education Scotland have done a lot of work there, along with GTC as well. And ourselves and other organisations have a range of opportunities for members to take up to support their own mental wellbeing. And when we have run sessions around about on those sorts of themes, we've had a very high uptake from members. So it's definitely an area of concern. And I think that we need to be careful about the asks of the system and asks of school leaders in this coming period, when we're still feeling the effects of the pandemic. And we all want the system to be in a better place than it is. We all want children to be achieving to their fullest potential, but we have to recognise the constraints that there are in the system and not try and get blood from a stone.
I'm a little bit surprised to hear that the head teachers and deputies in Scotland haven't considered the issue of the contract status of the teaching staff in Scotland. You would appreciate, I think, the difference it makes to have a permanent contract in terms of your life planning and your well-being. Is that a fair point that I'm making? That the contract
absolutely, status, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely fair point. My response is that my members have not come to me. They've not come to AHDS, our association, about those points, because the people directly affected by it would be going to their class teacher associations about that. One area that it has come up in the past is around about pupil equity funding, where schools have wanted to recruit staff or have recruited staff and have had to do it under a temporary contract because the funding is time bounded. And so in that context, in the past, my members have been raising concerns because they would like to be in a position, for the reasons you're describing there, convener, to be able to offer people permanency.
And you talk about the system, the stress that the whole education system is under. And I referred to that article from the Glasgow Evening Times about, I mean, are you generally satisfied from the Association of Head Teachers and Deputies in Scotland point of view? Are you satisfied with the supports that are in place for teachers in terms of their mental health and general wellbeing?
I think there are a lot of supports in place for those that need to take up that sort of support. But I think that's maybe the wrong end of the lens, in a sense. I mean, that support is there and that's important.
Yeah,
but I think that we need to be careful not to be pushing people into a position that they need to be accessing that sort of support.
Yeah,
and yeah, so
root cause. We've got to look at the root cause, is what you're saying, I think. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Bob Doris, who has a brief supplementary on the issue of contracts, and Bob will direct his comments to whoever he wishes to have respond.
Thank you, Convener. I think Simon Cavan would be the best place to answer the question. It was a fascinating exchange between yourself and Mr. Cavan. I think Scott Hill has been pretty clear that permanent contracts should be secured with this additional baseline funding. I wonder if Mr. Cavan could confirm that he anticipates to see many, many more permanent contracts as a result of this funding. And I would imagine, and this is the bit we need clarity on, Convener, I think, the reason for not flipping a current temporary contract into a permanent one, I suspect, maybe twofold. One, a local authority or so may wish to redeploy that resource to a different post in a school doing a different task elsewhere, but that contract should then surely be permanent, or they have to do some form of external recruitment to make sure you're abiding by recruitment and employment law. So I just want clarity. The expectations, there will be permanent contracts. Whether the configuration of staff as it looks at the current is one thing, but we are anticipating, indeed, Convener, I think we're expecting permanent contracts. So could Simon Cameron give us more clarity on that?
Simon Cameron.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dawes. Yes, absolutely. I think from our perspective, you know, the fact that the money has come through, and Greg actually picked up an important point that, you know, when we look at other forms of funding, particularly the PEF funding, etc., when something has got a temporary nature, that very much puts you into a situation that you have to offer a temporary contract with it, because you can't give somebody permanency where there is not that guarantee of the funding to go with it. The fact that the money that we've now got from the Scottish Government is baselined, will be there permanently in the system, the rest, is something that means that we can put in place permanent contracts. But for all the factors that both you've acknowledged and that I outlined previously, the rest, there is a fair and open process that people have to go through to make sure that they are appropriate and that the appropriate people are in the right places in the system. And clearly, as I said, you know, before we even went into COVID, we were carrying permanent vacancies in different parts of the country. That is something that we do need to look at. How do we attract people to all parts of the country where there is a great need? And where you, if you look at the recruitment that is going on, there has been a requirement to continuously re-advertise posts because we can't attract people to certain parts. So that's something that we're working proactively with colleagues on, something that we need to do in terms of the work, not only with our universities as well, to make sure that actually individuals coming through the system are being trained in the appropriate subject matter, so that's particularly in secondary level, obviously, but making sure that we get people to the right places. And when we do, and where it's appropriate, then yes, absolutely, we will expect to see a great many more permanent contracts in the system.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Bob. Doris, I'm going to turn to Stephanie Callaghan now, who's going to continue on the same theme of pressures that are on our teachers. Stephanie.
Thank you, Stephen. I'm trying to turn myself off there. Sorry, can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you, yeah.
All right, sorry, I can't hear me. It sounds a wee bit different than usual. Okay. So, what I wanted to ask was actually about what the impact has been on learning of Omicron in teachers and staff absences. And could I ask that, please, to Douglas Hutchison? Thank you.
So, sorry, I'm not 100% clear what the question is. Are you asking about the impact on learning and the impact on staff absence as two separate issues?
Yes, so the impact of Omicron on teacher and staff absences, yes.
Okay. Yeah, there clearly has been an impact on staff absence at the ADES meeting last Thursday morning, where most directors attend. We have an 8 o'clock meeting once a fortnight, and the issue was discussed there about the impact on staffing. It wasn't only teachers that were affected, obviously impacted on support staff at all levels, but also impacted on facilities management staff, which is a knock-on effect, impact on transport staff, getting children to school. So it wasn't just teachers that were affected. But in relation to the question of teachers, yes, there has been an increase. The general view was that schools were coping, but that was down to the good efforts of staff on the ground, of senior leadership teams, of local authority teams, and of staff of teachers. So generally speaking, schools were coping. There was clearly an increase in staff absences, but schools were continuing to run. And your question alluded to the issue of the impact on learning. There was a knock-on effect, and it wasn't just the fact that teachers were absent. So if, you know, the French teacher was absent, that would have a knock-on effect in the whole department. So the other staff were having to get classes ready. So it detracts from the work they're doing. So it's not just the case that that teacher is off and that class needs to be covered. It's the added pressure that puts on the others to get work ready for that class. So the quality of learning and teaching is impacted regardless of the total number of staff absent, because it has a knock-on effect across the school. Other people need to pick up. There's a higher number of please takes at secondary. There's potentially classes being distributed across to other teachers at various levels in the system. So generally speaking, yes, there was an impact. I mean, I understand there was about 5% of staff absent at one point, purely due to COVID absence, 5% of teachers due to COVID, but it's the knock-on effect that has on the quality of learning and teaching across the system, because the whole system's then under pressure. Every teacher is then put under pressure because there's additional work to keep the whole thing going. And to their credit, they have done it. To their huge credit, they have done it. But as Greg was alluding to, that comes at a cost. There is a cumulative effect of that level of additional work caused by staff being absent. So we've kept going because it is absolutely important that schools keep going. It's absolutely important that young people, children and young people, are able to get that regular experience of coming to school and keep that habit, and learning and teaching keeps going. But there is an acceptance that through this, there has been a knock-on effect on the quality of what schools have been able to offer.
That's great. That's really helpful. Thank you, Douglas. Just kind of following on from that then, are you finding that there's kind of quite a bit of variation then across the country, that there's different pressures, different places at different times? Are people stepping in to offer a bit of additional support outside their own areas? How is that kind of fitting together? How is it working?
Yeah, there is variation. I mean, even within, I've only been director in Glasgow City Council for all of 3 days, so I can't speak about Glasgow, but even in South Ayrshire, where I have just come from, there was variation. You would see the number of cases in one area. So in Girvan and North Carrick, at one point in time, there was a really high incidence of cases there. And so the schools there would be under particular pressure for a variety of reasons. But then it would seem to calm down there, and it would move to kind of Ayr, Prestwick, Troon area. So there was variation. Or you'd get a school where there was a significant outbreak in a few classes. Those classes would have to be home, or there would be a high incidence in terms of. So there is that variation. And if that happens in a small authority like South Ayrshire, that happens across Scotland. And we can see that in the case numbers. You know, at one point, a local authority is high, then eventually they come down that league table. So yes, there is variation. But in that context, you mentioned to people stepping in. I mean, I was aware from the discussions at the ADES meeting last week, for example, local authority staff are, you know, going back to cover absences. Teachers within school are covering each other's, you know, senior leadership teams in schools, as Greg, I'm sure, will allude to, are covering classes. So they're spending a lot of time covering classes, so they don't get a chance to do the normal development improvement work that they would like to do. So yes, people are being flexible in order to provide that level of resilience within the system. But again, that comes at probably a longer term cost, and the cost is around development improvement and in terms of a general sense of weariness in the system. So yes, people absolutely are being flexible within schools and across the system, I would say.
Well, are you finding just now then, Douglas, that you're at a point as well where you're able to do some planning then on how this is impacting the learning of pupils? Or is it not really at that stage yet because you're still kind of in the firefighting stage of that?
At this stage, you know, like, for all we're, you know, hopefully on the downward slope, case numbers are still very high. And so at the moment, it is a case of just getting through, to some extent, a day at a time. Clearly, people still have the eye on longer term improvement, on recovery. Schools are very good at that. I've been hugely impressed throughout the past 2 years with the way schools have dealt with the issues and continued to focus on improvement. They've continued to focus on how can we do this better. You know, if you look at the difference between, say, the first major lockdown and then the second, this time last year when schools were closed, people had learned from the first one. And so by the time we came to the second lockdown, the quality of remote learning had improved immeasurably. That's because we're part of a learning system. We're educators. We're good at learning lessons as we're going along. So at the moment, I'd say to a great extent, we're still in the thick of it. But people constantly have an eye to how can we learn, how can we do this better, how can we ensure that we don't just go back to business as usual, to, you know, like pre-pandemic. How can we take learning from this? So I've been impressed with the way we have learned up to this point, and that gives me confidence that that I'm part of a learning system, and that learning system will learn the lessons and still has an eye towards improvement. But at the moment, in a lot of schools, their experience will be, let's just get through today.
That's really, really helpful indeed there. Just finally, just to ask as well, what kind of impact is this having as far as prelim examinations are concerned as well, both the pupil and the student absences, I suppose, there, and whether you're feeling quite confident that should there be further issues with COVID, that result in further absences or that do result in school closures as we approach the exams, how confident are you feeling that actually the process will be much better this year and that it will be a satisfactory process and satisfactory outcomes for our young people?
It's difficult to say. In terms of prelims, I mean, the concept of prelims has changed over time. I don't think we exist in an educational world anymore where the prelim has huge prominence. It is one piece of assessment in a range of assessments or evidence gathering over the course of a school year. So the prelims have a place, but they're not. They don't have the significance they once had, you know. And schools are aware of what could have potentially happened over the course of this year. They'll have taken that into account. They'll have planned accordingly. They'll be clear about what assessment evidence they need in the event of having to make a teacher judgment. But the central planning assumption remains that there will be an exam diet. And the question then is, how do we take account of the disruption that has taken place, because there has been disruption. You know, back in September, case numbers were high just when we came back to school, and staff absence and pupil absence. And for the first time then, we weren't going into a closure. We continued to operate through high case levels, high staff absence, high pupil absence, as we have done now. And so that has an effect on the quality of learning and teaching. Schools are taking account of it. We just need to be clear on what the adjustments are going to be, and we probably need them sooner rather than later, I would say.
Just kind of for clarity there as well. So the kind of standard continual assessment material and evidence of the year, that seems to be absolutely fine. That seems to be there and very solid. Yes.
Well, I would say I would say schools have learned from the past 2 years and would be gathering assessment evidence as part of the normal process of learning and teaching. So it isn't about a one-off high-stakes prelim exam that will determine what happens in the event of say, for example, you know, if anything was to happen in terms of the exam diet. As I said, central assumption is the exams will go ahead, but if a young person wasn't able to sit their exam because they, you know, tested positive or whatever, then schools have been gathering a range of assessment evidence throughout the course of the year. Because if you think about prelims, a prelim only assesses the work you've done up to that point. You know, and if you're doing that just before Christmas or just after Christmas, you've still got a significant amount of learning to do. So all I'm saying is that prelims aren't the one-off high-stakes assessment evidence that will determine a young person's future, that they might once have been in the days when appeals were based on your prelim result, for example. So that isn't the case anymore. As part of the process of learning and teaching, teachers are gathering a range of assessment evidence throughout the course of the year. That's all I'm saying, really.
Okay, that's great. Thank you, Douglas. Thank you,
convener. Thank you very much. And just if I can bring in Margaret Wilson, the National Parent Forum of Scotland, just to comment on the impact that parents are feeling from teacher absences and the disruption of pupil absences and the delivery of education in general. What are parents telling you their experience about their experience, Margaret Wilson?
Hi there, thank you, convener. We're hearing quite a broad range of views, probably hearing more from senior phase pupil parents, if I'm being honest. They seem to be very concerned about the disruption to the learning and teaching for obviously the reasons that that have just been said, with the prelims and assessments and the exam diet still going ahead. But it isn't just the senior phase pupils, obviously, that have had their learning and teaching disrupted. It's been everyone. They're concerned that the focus again goes to the senior phase pupils, because that's what happened last year. But that, you know, that can't happen again. We need to focus on the piece, we need to focus on all years, but even just now, you know, you've got P7s that will be transitioning into secondary schools soon, nursery again moving up to primary ones, subject choice thing, you know, events going on that we need, you know. So there's a huge number of young people that have had their learning and teaching disrupted. And yeah, I think parents are really concerned at the moment about the numbers. Maybe we're turning a corner, hopefully, but it is quite concerning. And again, as we've said, we want, you know, the teachers feel safe in their school. We want our schools to remain open when it's safe to do so. That's obviously priority, but it's significant learning and teaching disruption that does concern everyone.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. And I know that Willie Rennie wants to come in with a brief supplementary on the exam diet, because that Margaret Wilson has just said that there's a lot of emphasis, a lot of concern among the parents of the age group of the pupils. But Willie Rennie, if you'd like to come in on exams.
Okay, so under scenario 2 of the plan, it indicates that revision support, for example, guidance on topics, will be provided to help learners maximise their exam performance and reduce exam stress. Do we know yet what's the content of that revision support? And I think if we ask Greg and then Douglas, I think, those questions.
Yeah. I'm not the best person for that. My association's primary nursery and special schools, so I have no secondary education input to offer you.
And Douglas?
Thanks, through you, convener. No, we don't know yet. The formal decision to move to scenario 2, I think, has yet to be taken. And once we move formally to scenario 2, then the specific guidance around content, the revision support, as it's called, would come out after that. So at this point, no, we don't know, because I'm not sure we've formally moved to scenario 2 yet. So the first stage would be a formal move to scenario 2, and then the next stage would be the information would come out on the changes to specific, you know, in terms of guidance around which specific topics are included in an exam or not included. So we're not there yet. We don't have that information.
I mean, should we not be moving to scenario 2 already? Because it's pretty clear there's been significant disruption to education with the absences that you've talked about of staff, but also pupils. A lot of pupils right now are in their prelims, they've got study leave. You know, if we don't know what the revision advice will be, how can we prepare pupils for those exams? Should we not be moving to scenario 2 now, so we can crack on with that?
That is the issue that's been discussed by the National Qualifications Group, the NQ22 group. That's a decision that will be made formally by the SQA, presumably. But yeah, my view would be the more information we have, the earlier, the better. In terms of reducing stress on the system, the more people know, the more information young people have, and the earlier they have that information, the more that, for me, that reduces pressure on young people, and it reduces pressure on teaching staff in secondary schools preparing young people for SQA exams. So my own view would be the sooner the better.
I think that's a pretty clear, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think it's a pretty clear message, and you're smiling now, you see, so I think you indicate that I think we should be moving towards scenario two so we can crack on with that. Yeah, thanks, convener.
But are there not, if I can go back to Douglas Hutchison, are there not set trigger dates for these decisions? I mean, clear that the timeline to the exams is pretty clear. I mean, that is known. Are there not dates by which decisions have to be made that are set, D-days, as it were?
Again, I'm not part of the NQ22 group. We have an IDS representative on that. My understanding is that there'll be a decision by the end of January.
And that is later than you would like it to be, is what I'm hearing you say to Willie Rennie.
All I'm saying is the sooner we know, the better. I think it reduces pressure in the system, but I can understand why the SQA, for their part, would want to take a measured approach and look at all the evidence and so on. Anyway.
And parents will have a view on this, Margaret Wilson.
I actually sit on the NQ22 group, so I've actually fed the parents' concerns. We sit on the NQ working group, steering group, comms group, every subgroup of the NQ22. The parents are represented there, and we have fed back our concerns and really asked for clearing.
Are there D days? Are there decision days for these things? Are there trigger moments?
There are triggers, but I don't think they're published so that they're not sort of targeted, if that makes any sense. You wouldn't want them to become targets. So, there are trigger points which are looked at.
Is Douglas Hutchison right when he says he thinks that trigger date for making a decision is at the end of January?
I think it's going to be soon, certainly as the parent, well, myself representing parents, we've said that we would really like a decision. Not saying soon is not good enough. We need to learn to relieve the anxiety that's out there. We need a decision, you know, as soon as possible. And obviously the plans in place so that there's no more disruption, really.
The sooner the better. The sooner the better is what you're saying in these groups, and they need
absolutely.
To make that decision.
Absolutely, and I would also stress that we've asked for clear and concise, communications, because they need to, when they release any information, it should be sort of three targeted groups. It should come out to the practitioners what they need to do, then reassuring messages to the young people and the parents. So it needs to be in really good language as well for parents, because sometimes we don't understand the language that's used because we're not, practitioners. So we've also called for really good, clear and concise communications when any decisions are made. And that's why we've been asked to be on these subgroups, is to help that if and where possible, really.
Now, the politicians don't understand the language either, Margaret Wilson. So, I mean, the parents and the politicians are good travel companions in this exercise. But what you're saying and what Douglas Hutchison is saying is decisions need to be made, and they need to be made pretty quickly and for the reasons that Willie Rennie described. I'm now going to turn to Ross Greer.
Thank you, convener. I'd like to start off on a different topic, though the one that I return to might end up touching on some of the issues that have just been raised. But I've got a couple of questions around ventilation in the first instance. So I'd be interested in probably Douglas and maybe Simon's perspective first, if this comes under your purview, Simon. But the £5 million of additional funding for ventilation improvements was announced by the Scottish Government last week. Are you clear on how you can access that at this point?
Do you want me to answer?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, We're in the process of working through that, and the discussions are ongoing with the Scottish Government and COSLA in relation to how that money will be accessed and allocated. Fairly advanced from what I've seen in terms of the process for accessing it. So Simon might be able to give a clearer answer, but based on what I've seen and the conversations I've been part of, we're at a fairly advanced stage of being clear on what the allocation is and how we access that.
Thanks. Simon, would you like to come in?
I'm off mute there. Yes, indeed, I can confirm that through the Scottish Distribution Group that the way that we have is that as part of the way that money goes out to councils in terms of this, we've been proactively working with Scottish Government just in the past week or so, taking that information to them. I believe they actually meet today, so we will communicate very shortly with all councils to let them know the allocations that they've been provided and the fact that the money will be coming. What we've been taking an approach is making sure that people know there will be funding there for them so that they actually can continue with purchasing the appropriate equipment that they require or putting in place the appropriate remedial works that they require as well. So we've been trying to make sure that there's not a delay to any of that in terms of this process. The money's obviously been announced. We know that it's there and we're just working through the final process of the distribution group.
Thanks. So just to clarify that distribution then, it's not the case that a local authority would have to either come to yourselves or directly to the Scottish Government with a worked up case as a bid before they're able to access the money. Are you aiming to give them certainty that a minimum amount will be available to each local authority and you will then work with them to develop the case for exactly how that's deployed, just so that it gets out quickly? They don't have to wait, prepare a bid, wait for a response to the bid before they know whether to proceed with it.
That's absolutely. We're making sure that they know money is coming. They're getting an appropriate proportion of that money. The rest required for them, and the rest there's guidance out with authorities at the moment. So that's enabling them to already continue with the process. It's not a case of having to put together a lengthy bid. Clearly, that would delay processes. There will obviously have to be appropriate auditing in place. So they will have to have the appropriate audit tool in place for that, but it will be distributed to them.
That's grand. Thanks very much. I believe colleagues are looking to come in with further questions on ventilation, so I'll move to my other area of questioning briefly. And it's to try and get a sense of how local authorities and schools are quantifying the social and developmental impact of the disruption of not just the Omicron wave, but since the beginning of the pandemic on young people. So to some extent, we can quantify the impact on educational attainment through the testing regime, national qualifications, exam results, etc. Trying to quantify that wider social and developmental impact is obviously much harder. Now, I presume at individual classroom level, teachers are able to identify what additional challenges their young people are facing as a result of the pandemic, and are hopefully able to then direct them towards, make sure that they can access the likes of school counsellors, educational psychologists. But there's an implication there for schools and for local authorities in terms of workforce planning, for you to have a clear idea of what the level of demand is going to be for those additional pastoral support services that you provide over the coming period. There's been some national survey work done, so for example by YouthLink Young Scot on the impact of mental health. What work are local authorities undertaking to try and quantify this additional social need that's going to have to be met through schools? If I could maybe go back to Douglas to start again with that one.
I suppose the question implies that we perhaps should be gathering that information either at local authority level or at national level. But the reality is the issues will be dealt with at school level. And one of the minor irritations throughout this pandemic has been the obsessive gathering of data and information, which has sometimes come at the cost of people actually doing their frontline job. to feed a machine. And so I just have a slight anxiety that the question implies we should somehow be gathering that data. But to go back to the essence of the question, the reality is, I mean, I'm out and about in schools, I meet regularly with head teachers, probably talking about in South Ayrshire rather than here in Glasgow, as I said, it's day three, but talking regularly to teachers, being in schools, talking to head teachers, there is a clear impact. You know, like teachers are saying, teachers are noticing that a primary three class this year are probably further behind socially and behaviourally compared to a primary three class last year, because they have spent such a lot of time either at home or not interacting with their peers or not in a normal class context. So there is an impact in terms of social skills, behaviour, development and so on, but that will be dealt with at school level. It's probably only at school level that skilled teachers, skilled practitioners will deal with these issues. The same is true at early years practitioners noticing children and their social skills and their interaction, because they haven't been interacting to the same extent. But again, it will be dealt with by the very same skilled practitioners. They'll deal with those issues. And it's probably only where there are chronic or long-lasting issues that they would then escalate through the local authority's normal staged intervention process and be dealt with at that specialist level by educational psychology, by CAMHS, by some of the supports that are available. But there has been a significant investment by Scottish Government in mental health, and it has been at that community level. And that has allowed local authorities, health and social care partnerships, to put in place a range of commission services, for example, from third sector organisations to be available to meet the needs. I mean, in South Ayrshire, the South Ayrshire Youth Forum do a mental health survey every 2 years, the Say It Out Loud survey, and get a sense of what the issues are. And they're very good at, they were very good at getting boots on the ground and getting face to face and chasing young people up. So they got a really good response. And young people, because it was a youth forum, were probably much more honest than if it had been, you know, like adults or a school-based survey. And that helped direct services. You know, like the level of self-harm, for example, that was reported in their survey was probably higher than a similar survey that had been done by Psychological Service. And so we were able to, in commissioning services, using the money from Scottish Government, we were able to target specifically the issue of self-harm. But that's when you're getting to the chronic or clinical end of the spectrum. For the vast majority of children and young people where they have lost ground or haven't had that normal social interaction that you would get by being at school, by being with your peers, that will be dealt with by skilled teachers, skilled practitioners, skilled support staff at school level. And it's probably only when it gets to the chronic level that would be dealt with through a school staged intervention process, and young people's needs would be assessed and met through the normal processes, I would suspect. So I don't know if that answers the question.
That's really useful. And just, I've got one brief follow-up, and this will be me, convener. So I accept absolutely what you're saying, Douglas, that the obsession with gathering data often results in taking folk away from delivering the service that they need to, and what you're saying about, you know, it's schools that will resolve these issues. But for a school to have the right skilled professionals to resolve the issues and to support young people with the challenges that they're facing, surely there's a wider workforce planning issue there for local authorities and governments. So, for example, for us sitting here at a national level, we need to know, is the significant increase in demand going to be for educational psychologists, or is it going to be for speech and language therapists? That there are long-term workforce implications here. You know, we knew a couple of years ago we were short of educational psychologists, so the bursary was brought back in to get more folk going into uni to study for that profession. But we don't know whether actually the demand is now going to be, for example, in early primary, is it going to be for speech and language therapists instead? And if so, do we actually have
the folk are qualified to go into to that workforce to meet that increased demand. Is there not a wider workforce planning issue here that can't be resolved at an individual school level? Because they can only resolve it if those skilled professionals are there and obviously the money to hire them is there as well.
Yeah, I mean, the short answer is yes. But that's, again, probably an issue that would be dealt with at community planning partnership level. So it would be probably for the community planning partnership to sit down and look at these issues and say, where do we need the resource? Is it specific, is it in CAMHS, is it in the level pre-CAMHS, that kind of community-based mental health supports and services that often third sector organisations provide very well? Or is it indeed speech and language therapy, as you suggest? You know, if young people haven't been socialising to the same extent, they're not exposed to the level of language that they would have been had they been attending nursery, for example. So, yeah, at community planning level would probably be the place where those discussions need to take place, and yet that could aggregate up to a national level from there.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ross Greer. CoCab Stewart.
Thank you, convener. I want to take us back to what Ross Greer touched on, was ventilation. So I just want to take a little bit of time here to drill down and get underneath some of the headlines that have been there. But first of all, I just want to put on record that, you know, as an ex-teacher, I'm really, really grateful to my colleagues, all the staff and parents and pupils from the profession who had to turn on a sixpence, and the amount of work that has been done has been amazing, and also councils across Scotland as well. So with regards to ventilation, I just want to ask about the sort of like the assessments that have been done. Now, it says in the COSLA report that 100% of the learning and teaching spaces were assessed by November 2021. And yet we have been hearing evidence from voices from within and out with the profession that there are inadequacies there. So can I get some more information, please, regarding that assessment of all the learning and teaching places and the mitigations that were made and how they were rectified and where we are along that process? How much more is there to be done as well? So can I direct that at Simon Cameron, please, from COSLA initially?
Hi there. Yes, thank you very much for the question. And obviously, work has been undertaken. There was a very kind of strict timeline that was set out when we initially did the work around ventilation, which was for October last year. And indeed, over 52,000 identified learning and teaching play spaces were all audited. And it's been a huge exercise, as you would imagine. And obviously, there's a great variation across all of those. Unfortunately, not all of our children learn and a joint or a very similar space, so it's not easy to roll out a one-size-fits-all approach here. However, in terms of the work that is ongoing, the remedial work, the monies that has been provided to authorities is being used to improve ventilation where it's required. Obviously, there has been a great range of the CO2 monitors provided across the country, and yet again, people have used a process that is fit for purpose for their local needs and their local area. And that work continues. And with the additional £5 million, obviously, they're now looking very closely at what further work is required. The process of going back around and doing an assessment of all those spaces on a weekly basis is starting to be undertaken so that we can make sure that yet again, the environment is as safe as possible and as healthy as possible. I think, you know, one of the things to note from ventilation is just the long-term benefit that there can be in terms of improving the ventilation in general, not only in teaching and learning spaces, but I think probably actually will follow through to other workspaces as well for everyone. So that work is continuing at pace. making sure that it's happening. And in terms of what we've done with our trade union colleagues, we've listened to the concerns in terms of individuals who maybe feel they're not clear on the guidance, they don't know where to access the guidance. We produced just before Christmas time a quick guide for all education staff. That was something that we did with all trade unions, and we send that out to the system. We share across social media platforms and by other means as well to make sure not only people knew the simple steps they could take in terms of ventilation, but also where they did have a concern, how they could access both the national guidance, but also very much, I suppose most importantly, the local supports available, the local expertise that told them if you get such and such reading, this is the best way to deal with it. These are the mitigations and the steps that you may take. So we tried to outline that in a one-page document so that people could very quickly go to it and hopefully reduce some of the stress that might be associated with the concerns that there are regarding ventilation. But the work very much continues. We've also proactively, through what we've got at cause of our workforce issues group, put a firm commitment out, and we've written out with Scottish Government to all trade union partners to state that if there are any local matters that are still coming up that they've got concern about, to contact us directly. And as we would do in any circumstance, and we do for a great many reasons, particularly in the employers team within COSLA, we will work closely with local colleagues to address the concerns that the individuals might have. That might just simply be about sharing good practice and letting people know the steps that they should take. It might just be clarifying matters in relation to funding and so forth. But obviously, whatever the concern might be, we stand ready to work proactively with colleagues to address them.
So I think it's important to get a strong message to staff and to pupils and parents, all stakeholders, that if they have concerns about ventilations in their environments, that there is a clear route that they can pursue in order to get those issues addressed. And those channels are open, and there should be no fear of judgment or repercussions. That is a clear route that is available for people.
I absolutely couldn't agree more. And yet again, our quick guide was absolutely the heart of that. Throughout the pandemic, in fact, and across a range of matters for employees across Scottish local government, we've always been very clear about the routes that are available to individuals. Firstly, obviously, you would always go to your line manager to seek assistance and help. Where that's not a route that is working for you, and do appreciate that sometimes that's not the route that works for every individual, obviously we've got health and safety teams, we've got HR teams who can provide support and guidance locally. There's obviously your trade union rep as well, and working closely with our trade union colleagues, particularly in the workforce issues group space. Yet again, we reiterate that point. And at all times, we did a campaign indeed. It comes back to haunt me every time I can't get off mute on my device, but we did a Don't Stay on Mute campaign. That was about individuals' mental health and wellbeing, and saying, if you have a concern, if you have a fear, or simply if you're not certain, remember that there are people out there who are willing to help, who are willing to listen, and who can support you to do the best in your role. So nobody should be under any doubt that the support and help is there. I suppose my only reflection for all of us is that we don't live in a world of 4 TV channels anymore. We've got far too many outlets for communication. So I think that's why we need to reinforce the point of working together with our not only our colleagues in councils, but in trade unions and any means. Another point I suppose I would just highlight is that COSLA has got a weekly elected members briefing, and all of the information that I've referred to has gone out through that, so that all of the councillors in Scotland can also support their constituents to make sure they know where to access information. So I think any means and all means that we can put the messages across is a critical point in this.
Thanks very much, Simon. Could I just turn to Douglas Hutchison, please? So, Douglas, first of all, I'd like to welcome you to your new post in Glasgow, day three, and you're in front of the Education and Children and Young People's Committee. So thank you for your contributions so far. Can you give us an indication from an ADES point of view about any concerns that you've heard across Scotland regarding ventilation. And that I'm not just talking about the use of HEPA filters or CO2 monitors, but I'm also referring to opening windows and getting that natural ventilation, being able to use doors. So what's the view of ADES around all that?
The advice is fairly clear that good ventilation is a key mitigation in relation to preventing the circulation of the virus. And so the funding that was made available to address the issue of CO2 monitors in, which is a proxy indicator of what the potential issues are, was welcome. We've gone through the process, and I mean, local authorities and schools will have a good supply now of CO2 monitors, but we'll also have identified, I mean, certainly I was aware of there was a small number of rooms and teaching spaces that were problematic. And so the job of addressing that will be ongoing so that we get to a point where ventilation is good. People can open windows, doors, and not freeze. But the situation is, I would say there's an acceptance and an acknowledgement that good ventilation is key, is a key mitigation, so let's get on with it. And we have at least some of the tools available in terms of CO2 monitors. So other than that, I'm not picking up any major issues.
Okay. You'll know that I worked as a teacher for many years, and buildings vary. You know, you have everything from sort of the Victorian buildings with the huge windows to more modern buildings that have internal ventilation systems. So I have an awareness that it is a complex issue, and catering for that does require individual local flexibility across authorities. So I just wondered any concerns anywhere across the country that were more than others, I suppose. But I think you've answered that. Could I just sort of ask, thank you for that, Douglas. Could I ask Margaret Wilson for a view from the parents? Because obviously we have heard a few voices regarding, you know, children freezing in classrooms, opening a window is not, you know, a simple solution, especially with the Scottish weather. It can get very cold. So I just wondered, from a parent's point of view, have you been hearing any major concerns about the effect of temperature on children? And I'm also thinking about, you know, wearing outdoor clothing inside. So any views on that from Margaret, please?
Thank you. There were a few concerns, obviously, when we were approaching the colder weather, that if windows were open, that children would be cold, and if they're cold, they won't, you know, they can't obviously learn if they're sitting there chittering away. But we do have to remember that when windows are open, they're not going to be open all the time. They might only be, the guidance, you know, can just be a few minutes just to let the air flow. However, the guidance, the school guidance, was also updated at the same time to allow schools to be more flexible with their uniforms, so children were allowed to wear more layers. We did get feedback, however, that some schools weren't being as relaxed, and I've fed that back through the COVID-19 recovery group, that at times we were hearing that guidance hadn't reached down into school levels, that they could obviously relax their guidance and allow children to wear outdoor clothing. But I haven't heard anything this side of Christmas that there's been any major concerns. And really, the only other ones were maybe from some more rural, sort of like the Highlands and the Islands, as you know, because obviously their wind is stronger up there. So obviously they were concerned about wind and doors and windows. But I haven't really heard very much this side of Christmas, if I'm being honest. There was a little bit of noise when there was a bit in the media, and I think that was addressed pretty quickly with this extra funding. So I suppose we as parents are then looking to see how that plays out, you know, when they invest in the schools, and yeah, our children should be safe.
Thank you, Margaret. That's important views that you have given there. Just to finish off, if I could ask Greg Dempster, please, from sort of a head teacher and deputy's point of view, ultimately, sort of like, you know, the school estate is huge, but of course it's important for us to remember that schools then drill down into small workplaces. So in that sense, it is quite a fragmented estate in that way. And I just think it's important to acknowledge the additional sort of like stresses and strains on school leaders. So I wonder if Greg could give us any insight. Has he heard from his members regarding any concerns with ventilation and whether the communication between themselves and their support services are effective? So any concerns that they have raised, have they been dealt with? And if not, is there anything that we can do better on that area?
Thanks, Gokub, and I'd like to thank you for your recognition of the efforts of school staff around the country, and that will be appreciated by them. So thank you for that. I think that in relation to the CO2 monitoring, and as Douglas described, that proxy that's used for air quality, there has been variable practice, variable experience around the country, just as there's been a variable experience in terms of staff absence that was talked about earlier, where there was 5,200 staff members off last week, but a quarter of primary schools didn't have any staff absence. It's something like that. I'm not accurate, I'm sure, with those figures. So again, the implementation of these protections by implementing the CO2 monitoring has proceeded at a different pace in different places. And so I think we're in a much, much better position this winter than we were last. The guidance then was throw open all your windows and keep them open. This year, people have been able to take a much more nuanced approach to that because they have had access to the CO2 monitors. But there's a variety of experience there. So you've got one end of the spectrum where every classroom in every school has a CO2 monitor at all times, and the teachers there have become very comfortable about recognising for how long they need to have windows open before the monitor returns from red to green. And also, I've heard about situations like that where teachers are saying, well, we don't need this anymore. We understand that. We don't need the monitor to tell us. We understand how often we need to purge the room and so on. The other end of the spectrum is where authorities are still gearing up with numbers of monitors so that there isn't a monitor available in every classroom every day, so they're being cycled around classrooms. But the weekly monitoring of every space, I think the concern, you were talking about impact on school leadership teams, there'd be a concern around about if there was flowing from that a requirement to collate and report on all of that information on a weekly basis. Actually, what you want is a response where there is a problem. You don't want to create busy work of collating and reporting on all of that. So that would be where my members would have a concern. That and the balance between ventilation and warmth. But as I say, in most cases that I've heard about, your teachers become comfortable about how often and to what degree they need to open windows, a lot of the anxiety disappears.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for that, Greg. So the message that I'm getting is that actually the guidance and the response is becoming more sophisticated, and staff and including leaders who have done an awesome job, I have to say, you know, head teachers are promoted as being sort of heads of teaching, and then they're having to deal with scientific evidence and health and safety and all the rest of it. You know, hats off to all school leaders at every level. So the advice is becoming through, and it is more responsive, but I'm getting that there needs to be more consistency across all authorities across Scotland. Would that be correct?
I think we're heading, we're in a much better position, as I said. That position has progressed. there is more consistency coming in. I'm hearing much less about ventilation, if I use that as a proxy.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thank you, convener. Thank you.
I'm going to ask a couple of colleagues to make quick, and I do mean quick, supplementary questions, starting with Bob Doris, to be followed by Michael Mara, and then we will move on to Michael Mara in his line of questioning. But obviously, time is now against us. We luxuriate at the first hour of our meeting in questions and answers, but now we're up against the clock. So, Bob Doris, followed by Michael Mara.
Convener, thank you. I would like to direct my question to Douglas Hutchison, and in doing so, I should declare an interest in what he asked about the EIS survey, and I still give my union dues to the EIS, so I should declare that before I mention the survey, and I should also welcome Douglas Hutchison to his post in Glasgow. Only 3 days in, I suspect the postbag is still is quite voluminous already, Douglas, but thank you for taking on that task in Glasgow. So the EIS survey on ventilation said that 65.9% of teachers thought that classrooms and rooms were well ventilated, but 29.2% did not. I'll just give one other stat for time, convener. Only give one other stat. 62.8% of teachers knew ventilation had been checked in rooms, but 11% did not. I just want to ask Douglas whether he was aware of whether leaders in education at a local authority level had used that EIS survey detail to go back to EIS and to drill down on the 29%, for example, who did not think classrooms were well ventilated, or the 11% that didn't know ventilation had been checked. So there's really important data there about a bit of a disconnect about some of the teachers at the coalface who were EIS members and some of the good practice we'd heard from Simon Cameron at COSLAS. I wonder if Douglas has got a view on how that data could be used, what discussions there could be with EIS to do something positive in relation to this.
Short response, please, Douglas.
The short answer is I don't have that data. I would just say that it's, 65.9% of respondents, not 65.9% of teachers. But I would also say that my expectation would be that the issue would be brought up at the local negotiating committee for teachers, and that's where it would be discussed. I think it would be reasonable to have that survey discussed at that level so that it's clear that where the issues are and how a local authority is addressing those issues. But I'm not aware across the country of how local authorities are using it. But the obvious place for me would be the LNCT.
OK, thank you.
Thank you. Michael Mara.
Thanks, convener. Bob Doris actually covered part of my question. I suppose, following on from that, though, I wanted to ask Simon Cameron at COSLA whether any discussions have begun with the Scottish Government or with the local authorities to make sure that we don't have a third year of this situation. So we've gone through 2 years. We've heard some anecdotal evidence that things have perhaps got a little bit better in different places. The response has obviously evolved in some instances. But what can we do over the next year? Will this work continue, or are we looking at a case of, you know, another set of panic next winter?
Okay. Thank you for the question. I think, you know, absolutely, from our point of view, we are continuing working closely, not only with Scottish Government colleagues, but also other partners, namely organisations like the Scottish Futures Trust, to look at this work. And what we have very much recognised, and I think what I alluded to in my earlier response, was that this is not just something that is of benefit during COVID times. This is something that we need to look at longer term. So the work that we've got going on now will continue longer term, because it is about an improvement in general of the teaching and learning spaces that we've got available to children and young people. So I think as we become more and more aware of what the benefits of this will be and the rest for that environment, then we'll continue on. So yes, very much so, I would say, you know, and that's where we need to get into very much the understanding for colleagues on the ground and making sure they're comfortable and understand what the best practice could be for them as we move forward.
That's great. I'm sure the committee would appreciate to hear about some of that work in writing in the coming months as it develops, and perhaps the programme of discussions that you might be having with the Scottish Government and colleagues on that. It would be good to receive that as a committee. Convener, if I can, given time, I'll move on to my substantive line of questioning, if that's okay. So the committee has repeatedly heard about a lack of overall analysis in terms of the impact of the pandemic. On, and particularly the differential impact, you know, who has suffered the most, what requires, who requires the most intervention. So I'm just wondering, in terms of this return to school in this this period at the moment, any reflections that members, the witnesses might have about that differential impact, who has suffered the most, and maybe hear first from Greg Dempster.
There's been a very clear message that certainly I've heard that the impact has been greater in areas of deprivation than elsewhere, and that I think goes back to the period periods of lockdown, when the opportunities to engage in remote learning weren't available to the same degree to those families or those communities. So I think that's where it stems from, but there haven't been revelations about how to go about education differently since the advent of the pandemic, as it were. You know, so what the system needs and what pupils need is time and continuity of learning opportunities, and both of those require staff. And we could see from reports last year that progress was being made on. Started to be made on closing the poverty-related attainment gap, and Omicron has come along and got in the way of efforts to identify the issues that you're asking about and to start to address them. But the mechanisms, as Douglas was talking about earlier, the mechanisms for addressing areas or individual pupils that need additional support are already in place within schools. And it is time and continuity of learning opportunity that we require.
Thanks, Greg. Margaret Wilson, can I maybe ask you to comment just in terms of representations you might have been having about different groups that have been affected disproportionately?
Hi there. Thanks, Michael. This is quite a hard one because obviously I only hear from very switched on parents. Parents who are engaged, and again, that is usually down to the same, you know, areas of deprivation that you're talking about. So it is quite a difficult question for me to answer, probably. But we have, as a parent group, worked in the past with the Child Poverty Action Group. And we're now actually in talks with the member Scottish Government with the Scottish Attainment Challenge. So we are going to see if there is anything that the National Parent Forum really can do to help these families. We have done workshops recently with the Child Poverty Action Group. I need to spell it because CPAG and abbreviations. But we have done help with them. In particular, we're going to be updating the Parent Council toolkit. So that's obviously, again, parents within the schools, as you know, you'll all know what a Parent Council is. But certainly just to recognise the cost of the school day again. And so we are starting to reach out, but yes, we're very aware that as the National Parent Forum, mainly we hear from parents that are already engaged with their with their children and learning, and that's where we are really trying to reach out and try and help. So we're doing that, as I say, through partnership with the Child Poverty Action Group, and we're just in a meeting with the Scottish Attainment Challenge colleagues in government to see if there is anything we can do to support them.
Thanks, Margaret. Thank you. Douglas Hutchison, is there, obviously Greg and Margaret have both mentioned issues of deprivation, just whether that's a shared experience from you and your own members, and if there are any other groups that you feel have been disproportionately impacted?
Yeah, it is largely what has already been said. People with existing vulnerabilities, and deprivation is a vulnerability, but so also is age. You know, so if I the kind of very quick analysis I had done of the curriculum for excellence levels, for example, it seemed to me that it was the youngest and most deprived children who had suffered most when you looked at that data. But also that there are other groups there, you know, like children and young people with complex additional support needs struggled, and their families, some of their families probably struggled when schools were closed, because schools were such a significant part of that young person's life and that family's life. So generally the picture is probably one where there were existing vulnerabilities, and the biggest one there being deprivation, but also age and additional support needs, I would say, have been impacted significantly.
Thanks, Douglas. Simon, can I ask you, do you believe there's been a larger impact in the most deprived communities, those areas where there's concentrated multiple deprivation?
I'm sure there has been impacts in those areas and the rest. And clearly, I think one of the key things that we've got to think about is that this takes a whole system approach. There's an awful lot that won't be able to be tackled within the school. There's an awful lot about bringing in other professionals and other services and making sure that the whole system is funded to support those individuals to live the fullest life they possibly can and overcome the barriers that they face and the challenges that they and their families face on a daily basis. I think if you look at the Live Well Locally campaign, and indeed if you refer to the previous submissions made to the committee, in terms of, as Douglas has alluded to, not only in terms of those living in poverty, but also children with additional support for learning needs and so forth, there is a huge support network that is required to go around them. So whilst teachers play a critical role in terms of the attainment, all of the staff and all of the services that individuals will come into contact with in their local communities, not only delivered by councils but also by our partners in the third voluntary sector and beyond, are essential. So we do need to take a serious look at how we make sure that all of that is funded appropriately and that we use that money in a way that will change the life outcomes and the life expectancies of those in most need of our communities.
That's really useful, Simon. I mean, obviously, quite a lot of those interventions and working with outside agencies has been funded in different places through the Scottish Attainment Challenge. So I want to ask a couple of questions about the reforms that have been undertaken. So many of the local authorities with the highest level of multiple deprivation are losing up to 60% of their Scottish Attainment Challenge funding. Dundee is losing 80% of its Scottish Attainment Challenge funding. Could you tell me what you believe the rationale to be behind that policy change?
As you said, I can't directly talk to that, but what we can do is come back to you with an answer in terms of where that may be. Clearly, it's something we need to work closely on. It's something that, you know, at a local level and the rest, we need to consider what the impacts will be and make sure, I think, come back to the point that actually how we advocate for a whole system approach, and indeed that the funding that we get for local authorities cuts across all the services that we deliver, but also that we support and work with our partners to deliver to make sure that we're putting in place the right processes for individuals at a local level.
I mean, if I can push you a little bit on that, Simon, I mean, this is a headline change to the way that this policy is delivered across Scotland. I know that in Dundee, currently, the Scottish Attainment Challenge money supports 120 staff. I believe 25 of those staff are to be cut this year as a result of this cut. And over the period of this Parliament, 80% of the entire funding will be lost. So around about 100 members of staff working directly with the most deprived members of our community. Areas like speech and language therapy, which we've heard about earlier on, suffering immediate cuts. So this is an approach. Do you know, was this something that was brought forward by the Scottish Government to COSLA, and then COSLA agreed to on that basis, or what's I don't understand the rationale for this shift, COSLA's perspective.
From COSLA's perspective, obviously we are in constant negotiation with the Scottish Government. We're trying to make sure that we can work towards all of the outcomes that we share nationally and locally. and we continue to engage in that. We will always engage in a manner that is seeking the best financial outcome for local authorities so that we can deliver services in the best way possible. Obviously, we want to tackle the attainment gap. We want to bring in services beyond the school gate, and we need to continue to work in that vein. And press the point that, yet again, it comes back to that whole systems approach and that it's all parts of the system working together. So we continue in proactive discussions around that. And I suppose I would point back to the Well locally campaigning there and the requirement there is to look at that whole system.
Okay. I don't really feel we're getting any we're particular with that, but I'm sure we'll come back to it on another occasion. If I can, Convener, I'm just going to close off with another issue, which is related to this reasonably closely. On the 17th of November, I raised the issue of missing pupils or missing learners, which are kind of first analysis of the figures, looking at about 1 in 100 young people in Scotland who have basically not attending school anymore. That's around about 6,900 kids across Scotland. I saw yesterday that the Children's Commissioner in England is launching an inquiry into children who are not attending post-pandemic. I just wonder if I could take any views from the panel in terms of their experience of this, what lens, how closely they're looking at this issue, any evidence they have, and whether they think it's a matter that we should be, as I am, concerned about. Douglas, can I ask you first of all, please?
Sorry, I was waiting to be unmuted there. It's anecdotal, but what I'm hearing is that there are young people who have a heightened anxiety about coming back to school due to COVID. So young people who might have been predisposed to a degree of anxiety anyway, it has been exacerbated, and schools, education support workers, educational psychologists are working with those young people and working with those families. So I'm not saying for a second that they are, you know, like the 6,900 that you reference, but I do get a sense that there is a group of children and young people with increased anxiety about returning to school, and it is a case of working with them in the same way that we would with young people pre-COVID, in order to build up their confidence, address their fears and anxieties, and enable them to return part-time initially and then full-time eventually. So, and all I'm saying is that anecdotally, I'm aware that there is a group of young people for whom return to school has been problematic, not just at secondary, at primary as well. So, and schools and local authority staff, educational psychologists are working with them to try and address those issues.
Okay, thanks very much, Douglas. Greg, any insight?
Not on that, but on your previous point, I think that the attainment challenge and the changes to that, there's another element of that that I'm a little concerned about in the current situation, and that relates to the language that's been associated with it as this new evolution of the attainment challenge has been unveiled. And it's talking about accelerating progress rather than, it sounds like it's not wanting to start from where we are, wanting to start from where we might like to be. And I think that that's unhelpful in a situation where there's a huge amount of pressure on school leaders and school teams caused by the pandemic. They know what needs to be done, and all parts of the system are working hard on it before the pandemic. Accelerating progress is perhaps an unhelpful way to present it.
Okay, I think we would take that on board, Greg. Margaret, can I finally come to you?
Very briefly, Michael, we do need to move on now.
Thank you, Camille. I appreciate that. I just wanted to give Margaret the chance to comment on that. Douglas was talking, I think, about a fairly comprehensive, I hope, approach to making sure that young people can return. Is that something that's been feeding through your networks about anxiety amongst young people and what we can do to try and address that?
Hi, thanks, Michael, for the question. Yeah, I would have said that this was probably more of an issue the first, after the first lockdown, that we kind of heard more about that. There was quite a few queries came into us about withdrawing from school and doing homeschooling and things like that. So I haven't really heard about as much now, but yeah, there is support out there as Douglas says, for pupils with heightened anxiety and supporting them to get back to school, as far as I'm aware. But no, it hasn't been something that we've probably heard for a while.
Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. And again, my appeal for brevity in the questions and the answers because of the time limitations we're living with. Can I turn to Fergus Ewing? Fergus.
Thank you, convener. Could I just begin by expressing my thanks to the excellent work that teachers and others in our schools do. My question relates to the use of digital technology. The Scottish Government have provided £25 million in order to assist the provision of a digital device to children and young people, particularly those identified as being at risk of digital exclusion. And I know that a lot of good work has been done by local government in distributing these devices. I've got the stats, but in the interest of brevity, I won't read them out. But what I want to ask is this. One wouldn't hand out a violin or a trumpet to a child without arranging for that child to get tuition in how to play the instrument. And it does seem to me that there's a sort of taking for granted that if we just hand out a digital device, that in itself will suffice. Whereas the essential skill, convener, I would submit, in the use of these devices is the facility to touch type and therefore allow the brain to concentrate on what one wants to say rather than in finding the keys on the keyboard concentrating on what rather than how. And touch typing is a skill which in this digital age will be essential for people in many, many walks of life, and is not a skill that is naturally acquired. I understand it takes between 15 and 20 hours of the correct repetition exercises in order for the brain to acquire the facility to identify the keys automatically without thinking, and therefore to allow one to apply one's brain with full 100% effort. So having set out that thesis, I wonder if I could perhaps ask Mr. Dempster and Mr. Hutchison if they agree with my analysis and if they can explain to what extent touch typing is something that is for where proper courses of monitoring and tuition, as I say, 15 to 20 hours is what is required, can be provided. And if not, should there not be a facility for every school to have teachers trained in how to teach touch typing by an expert? And would that be something that would provide a tremendous additional skill for our children in Scotland? Thank you.
I think that your to what extent question and the training question I'll perhaps leave to Douglas, but the part that you're asking about whether we agree with the premise that touch typing is an important feature of handing out devices, I think to an extent I would agree, because there is a lot of different ways in which devices are used for supporting remote learning. It may be to provide resources that are then printed off and used in the younger age groups. It may be things that you're reading on screen and interacting. So typing is only one element, and also voice input is more and more a usable and useful way to put together documents in situations where you and I would sit at a keyboard to do it. That's not necessarily how everybody would approach it these days. I'm drawing on the observation.
Mr. Hudson?
The question for me would be, I suppose Greg has alluded to it, the investment for the return, you know, for such a significant investment, would you get the return you wanted? Because in terms of devices, and obviously only here day three, but I'm aware that Glasgow has invested significantly in iPads, for example, which you can use a keyboard with an iPad, but generally speaking, you're not going to be doing that. You know, so handheld devices tend not to lend themselves to keyboards, and as Greg said, you know, like we will get much better at voice input, for example. But a lot of the interaction isn't entirely text based. You know, a lot of the interaction with digital devices may well be maths games, for example, that don't require input. I suppose for me there's a question mark. I'm just not 100% sure that the significant investment in touch typing would give the return that merited that level of investment. I suppose I would need to see the evidence that suggested that that would be a worthwhile investment that would get a significant return given the nature of the way devices are used for learning. They're not, you know, it's sometimes young people have been creating content, will not just be consuming content or, you know, doing essays on a device. They will actually be creating content for publication online or for others to interact with. So I think it's the use of devices. Devices lend themselves to a far wider range of methods of learning than simply reproducing or inputting notes through or create, you know, writing essays through a keyboard. So anyway, there's just a question mark on it for me. I don't know is the short answer.
Well, I hear what is said in response. The point I'm making really is that the ability to express oneself through touch typing rather than the sort of two-finger approach where the brain is focusing on identifying particular key, a particular letter or number on the keyboard, that skill is something that is of tremendous advantage in life for a huge range of occupations where one does need to express oneself. In particular, it's difficult really to think of many areas of work other than some manual labour where one doesn't require to express oneself. The evidence does show that touch typing means somebody is 300% more productive than somebody who cannot touch type. It shows, I believe, that children with dyslexia can gain in particular, that those who come to Scotland from other countries with other languages vastly increase their literary skills by being able to touch type quickly, that some children with special needs will benefit in particular, that all children who are able to touch type develop greater confidence in their abilities, that some people who find handwriting difficult, and I'm a left-handed person, and you tend to smudge the ink as it hits the page, find typing a less sort of physically arduous thing to do, particularly in the examination context. So I think the evidence is there for everybody to see. So I must say, Convener, I'm pretty disappointed with these replies. And I do think this is an area where the education establishment needs to think carefully about whether we are letting children in Scotland down. And the last thing I would say, Convener, is that in other countries, touch typing is a mandatory part of the curriculum. And I can provide more evidence about that. So I do hope that we can maybe come back to this further, because it would be sad if children in Scotland are missing out on a skill which in other countries is regarded quite properly as central to functioning in the modern digital age by the proper use of the QWERTY keyboard, which cannot be acquired naturally.
Thank you. Thank you, Fergus, Ewan. Willie Rennie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I want to talk about additional support needs. And I'm keen to understand whether we know that we're addressing the need, because the only measurement that I can see is the one that's been identified by the Scottish Children's Services Coalition this week, who highlighted a sharp decline in the number of legally binding education support plans. It's down by around 59%, so a significant reduction, and only a tiny number of those who've been identified with additional support needs are getting one of these plans. So I'm interested in understanding whether we are actually addressing the need and how we know whether we're addressing the need. And I'd quite like to start with Greg Dempster first, if that's okay, then I'll come to Douglas.
I'll be very brief in the interest of time. What I frequently hear from members is that identifying the need clearly is the first step, and that within schools there's only so much that they can do in that regard. They sometimes require external support to formally identify additional needs. And then the next hurdle after that is accessing the required support. And in all the time that I have been in this role, which is 19 years, I think, something like that, I've never heard members saying that all of the supports that they require are there. It's often at the other end of the spectrum where they're saying they're having great difficulty in accessing the supports that they require for their pupils, whether that is in terms of pupil support assistance within the school with adequate time to support individuals appropriately, or external additional supports, whether it's educational psychology or speech and language and so on. So I would respond by saying that we do know that there is a high amount of additional needs out there where schools would like to see additional support for pupils.
And that's really helpful. But I mean, we're now talking about a third of all pupils are in this category, and the mainstreaming approach is quite a radical change. And I get constant complaints from teachers, pupils and parents that there's just not the adequate support there. So what I'm interested in is, you say there's never been a time where it's been adequate. Has it got worse or has it got better?
I imagine the answer to that is different depending on where you sit in each individual school, because sometimes posts are formed and they rest within a school for a while, even if a child moves on. So the support experienced in different places would be very different. But over the piece, in a shorthand answer, my impression from the responses I get from members would be that that position is becoming worse because there are more needs identified.
That's very helpful. Would Douglas Hutchison like to comment on this?
I would start by saying I think we've made huge progress in Scotland, and I think we need to recognise that, because I mean, when I started teaching involving additional support needs, special educational needs, as it was called then, you only had special educational needs if you had a record of need legally. And so it was a tiny, tiny number of children and young people whose needs were ever formally and legally recognised. So the 2004 Additional Support for Learning Act, and then as it was amended in 2009, was a huge step forward. So in Scotland, essentially, you've got additional support needs if you need additional support. And that's why 30% of our children and young people have additional support needs of one kind or another. Obviously, there are a broad range of needs from, you know, like a young person can have needs because they're bereaved, because, you know, some tragedies happened in their family and that may be temporary, and then they no longer have additional support needs, to the very complex young people with additional support needs in specialist schools who only access the curriculum through a sensory, through iBlink or whatever. So a broad range of young people. But I would start by saying, I think in Scotland, we have come such a long way in relation to this. But the reality is that the legal duty is to meet those additional support needs, but you do that. So the law says, you know, as a director, I have a legal duty to meet all those additional support needs, but the reality is there's a limited resource to do that. And so the job becomes managing that resource to ensure we meet those needs as best we can with the resource available. There is a finite resource and there is a significant demand. So it becomes about managing that resource and skilling up every teacher in every classroom to be able to meet the broad range of needs. Because again, going back to the definition, you know, if I have Mrs. Trunchbull this year as my teacher, or sorry, if I have Miss Honey this year, she's a great teacher, I don't have any problems, and then next year I have Mrs. Trunchbull, suddenly I've got additional support needs because she's not helping me access the curriculum. I haven't changed. The external environment has changed. So, in short, there's a significant demand and a limited resource, and so local authorities have systems and processes in place to make sure, as best we possibly can, that we are able to meet those additional support needs and ensure that the staff who have that daily contact with young people are well placed and well trained to meet all those additional support needs.
Thanks for explaining the process, but what I really want to understand is, because I do get a lot of frustrated parents and teachers and pupils who feel their needs are not being met, and that not just affects the pupils themselves who have additional needs, but everybody else in the class as well. So what I'm keen to understand is whether it has got better from your perspective, and if it's not, what are you saying to government about changing this? What are you saying to your councillors in the various authorities about priorities? Because if it's not getting any better, as Mr Dempster has highlighted, in fact, it's getting worse, what are we doing about it?
I'm not clear what the evidence is for it getting worse, I suppose, is my answer. Almost all of my career I've been involved in additional support needs. You'll know that I'm an educational psychologist. And before that, you know, I taught in a residential school for children and young people with social, emotional, behavioural needs. I was a behaviour support teacher. I have lived and breathed additional support needs almost my entire career. It has always been a challenge. I cannot remember any time where it has not been a challenge. But the legislation that was introduced deliberately introduced a range of remedies for parents that didn't exist before, who were unhappy with the level of provision. That in itself acknowledges and recognises that this is a contested area. This is an area where it is always going to be difficult to meet all of the needs. So for me, it has always been challenging, but I'm not clear that it's any better or any worse now than it was 10 years ago or 15 years ago.
What does Margaret Wilson think?
Hi. Again, this will be a difficult one because we'll only hear from parents whose needs aren't being met. So I guess, and with the pandemic, more children could be deemed to have an additional support need as well. And anecdotally we have heard that from parents that don't feel their needs are being met, but I I'm kind of like Douglas, I don't know whether it's any worse or whether it's staying the same, because I don't know how we would find that out, if I'm being honest. But we signpost them to Inquire, which is obviously a body that can help parents. So we do have parent representatives on many of the groups that Scottish Government have for additional support needs, and we definitely gather feedback into it. But if you're asking the question, has it got worse? Anecdotally, I would probably say yes, but I don't know how you could measure that, like what Douglas is saying.
Yeah, I think I'll finish there, convener.
Thank you, Willie, and thank you for those responses. Turn now to Bob Doris. I know Bob has made a couple of interventions on subjects I know he wanted to cover. Bob, is there anything further that you would wish to cover with our witnesses this morning?
Yeah, there is. I had some, thank you, convener. I had some, and hopefully brief, some further questions in relation to absence levels and the stress putting on schools, just out of conscious of this evidence session, primarily about the pressure Omicron and COVID still putting on education. That was the primary function of today's evidence session. Now, we heard about teacher absence levels. We heard in the passing, I think it was from Greg Dempster, that they're possibly currently sitting around 5%. I think I heard that figure. The figures we have in our briefing is that teacher and all staff absence levels, support staff as well, was out in November was 2,134, middle of December was 3,290 or so, and I think last week it was 5,200 for teacher and support staff. So the trajectory is still increasing. I think this committee would be keen to know, does the witnesses believe that's going to increase further? What is the modelling work around when that will taper off and when that will start to dip? Because the more it increases, the greater strain are put on schools. We're, of course, looking at the impact on education. So, Greg, I think it was yourself that gave the 5% figure. So can we maybe bring Greg Dempster in? If I've got the wrong person, I apologise, convener.
I didn't say the 5%, but I did say the around about 5,200 staff were absent on the 12th, or the data that was published on the 12th of January. So that's 5,200 staff rather than 5,200 teachers. I think it's about an even split between teachers and those in other roles within schools. And that the trajectory of absences over that last period was pretty exponential, as we've seen across different walks of life. The data, the next set of data that we would get would relate to today, but we don't see it until tomorrow. So we're yet to be able to see in hard data whether that trajectory is continuing or if it's plateauing or if it's falling back a little. It has been, in the feedback I've had from members around the country, very variable. Some have still continued to have 20, 30, 40% staff absence, while others have got little or no staff absence. So, but there have been those that I keep in touch with regularly. Some of them have been seeing reduced levels of staff absence because of the change to the isolation rules.
I suppose what I'm interested, you know, convener, is that trajectory continues, and hopefully it doesn't, and regionalised it could be far higher, is when we get to a critical mass where we have to move to the next level, if you like, of the step change in relation to the exams and additional supports been put in place. I think Mr. Rainey was propagating. The absence level for pupils on the 7th of January was 7.1% from COVID. And I'm sorry, it's not a specific witness, convener, but does any of our witnesses know what the latest figures are for pupil absence and what any modelling work shows for what that's likely to be?
I would, convener, if okay, come in and say that there is figures collated on a regular basis by colleagues in public health and indeed reported to the CERC, so I'm sure we can get some information to the committee just in relation to what the figure is at the moment. I think, as Greg has alluded to, not only across both, and what I would say very much on an anecdotal basis as well, having just spoken with all of the heads of HR across Scotland recently, we are starting to see a decline in terms of absence levels. We're seeing absence levels for other reasons over and above COVID, clearly, and the rest. We're starting to see a reduction in those. Obviously, that will be different in different parts of the country for individuals in different circumstances. Obviously, in terms of the changed process for self-isolation, that has had an impact in terms of what we've got. But I understand as well that there is potentially a dip with those for children and young people. But clearly, we can come back to the committee with relevant information on that.
And my final question, convener, and I suppose if the trend's going down the way, then that's positive, and hopefully that endures. But I suppose my final question is, how have schools improved at managing pupil absence? So my son just now, he's at primary school, he's got COVID, he's self-isolating. Within 24 hours, there was a core literacy and numeracy package provided by the school, along with some bespoke work that the class is doing at the time. I suspect at the start of the first wave of COVID, schools were scrambling about to do the best they could. Hopefully, there's a lot more finesse and capacity in the system now. Perhaps Greg Dempster's best placed to answer this question then. Staff have to be present to issue the work out to pupils that are self-isolating. If the staff themselves are absent and there's other staff filling in, doing police takes and everything else, there's a staff management issue as well in getting good quality core resources out to pupils that are also self-isolating to keep the continuity of learning. So can you say a little bit more, Greg Dempsey, about where we are now at this stage of COVID and what those constraints are in relation to making sure we get good quality teaching and learning packages out to young people that are self-isolating?
Certainly. On your previous point, the absence rate for pupils was down to 4.1% on the 11th of January, so it did show a drop. In terms of that point that you're making there around about supporting pupils who are at home through isolation, yes, the practice around that has evolved and improved. Clearly, it's very difficult to support both classes and pupils at home. And you talked about the different roles that staff might play in trying to do that. You've got different staff groups there with different potential solutions as well. You've got staff who are off with COVID and who are unwell and who are unable to work. You've got staff who are off isolating or who have COVID but are not unwell and are able to set some remote learning. And then you've got the staff in school who are trying to maintain in-school learning and sometimes additionally provide a degree of remote learning for those who are absent and isolating. Because there have been those previous periods of remote learning, schools are much better geared up to be able to respond with resources than they were at the start of the pandemic. It's been a clear evolution of practice. But it is still hugely challenging because if you've got high levels of staff absence, then everything starts to creak. You've got school leaders who might be able to pick up that sort of thing normally, where they are actually covering classes themselves from the start of the day to the end. So the ability to provide resources to pupils who are isolating does depend on the degree of the staff absence that an individual school is facing.
Convener, that was very helpful. I have no further questions, but I can see Margaret Wilson's put a request in to speak. So with your permission, Convener.
Absolutely. Margaret.
Hi. Thanks. I just wanted to make a point that on your question, actually, because you'd spoke about, you know, the investment on the devices that have come out to pupils. I just wanted to make this point that certainly, because we have the National Parent Forum have a representative in every local authority, so we can get information quite quickly, you know, a good picture across Scotland, just to make you all aware of that. But you know, we're hearing, you know, that some schools don't let the devices come home, so only, you know, primary sixes and sevens maybe get their device home. So if that pupil is off, you know, self-isolating for, you know, or is off with COVID, you know, for whatever reason, they might not have access to that device. So you know, that has certainly come up a few times within our sort of group, if you like. And what you were saying, and I absolutely agree with Greg, it's very, very difficult to obviously, if you're in class, you know, support the pupils that are then at home. Absolutely agree with that. But again, it's different right across Scotland. You've got some pupils who are off and getting, you know, work home, and then you're getting pupils who are getting absolutely nothing. So it's not a level playing field. I would say out there. And again, it also comes down to parents at home, whether they can then help their child with that learning or if they're working from home. And it's all about the balance. I just wanted to kind of make that point, if you don't mind. Sorry. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, Margaret. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Bob Doris. Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to come back to one of the topics I already covered first before moving to my main line of questioning, and that was to ask about the IT devices. And I don't want to kind of return to touch typing, which we've covered at length, but I'm much more concerned, given the promises made by John Swinney before the election, that every young person in Scotland would have a device, and that device would be connected to the internet, whether or not that's the panelists' experience of what's happened, because in my own constituency, I'm not clear that that's the case. And we saw figures suggesting that it may be only 1 in 5 young people have access to a device on that basis.
Who's that directed to?
I'm happy to hear from anybody, whether or not they believe that promise has been fulfilled, that every young person has access to an electronic device and the associated internet connection.
Free device and a free connection. Right. Who would like to take that one on?
Happy to come in, convener, if okay. What we understand and what we know to be the case is that over 122,000 digital devices have been distributed to children and young people. That includes 72,000 devices provided to children and young people who have been identified by the schools as being at risk of digital inclusion. And that's obviously supported by £25 million worth of funding to ensure that there is over 14,000 connectivity solutions provided. I think work continues at pace across authorities. Obviously, it's not a straightforward process of rolling out in one fell swoop, so there is a great deal of local effort still continuing in the rollout of the programme and making sure that we get as many children who are at risk of digital inclusion connected.
Do you think it would be fair, therefore, to say this is another example of the sort of gap between the rhetoric we hear from the Scottish Government and the complexity of the task they then ask local authorities to deliver on the ground?
It clearly is a complex task. What we have agreed with Scottish Government is that whilst there's not a set timetable as yet, that we are forming a joint governance with them to oversee the rollout of the devices so that actually we can make sure, as we say, that we're getting it out to children and young people as quickly as possible, particularly those in the greatest need, and address, obviously, the issues that there will be in terms of connectivity and the challenge that this presents.
Yeah, I mean, I think many parents, young people and teachers get frustrated at these promises that things are going to be free and the suggestion they're going to happen quickly before an election, and then I'm sure is best efforts if things take a long time. But I won't kind of push you on the political point again and again. The kind of main question I wanted to ask was around the use of face masks in school. And whether you and the organisations you represent support the indefinite use of face masks, or whether you recognise we're at a point in the response to COVID-19 where we should be looking to have them removed as quickly as possible.
Directed towards myself, yes.
Happy for anyone to come in at that point.
Yeah, I suppose I would just reflect for you quickly. Obviously, what we are happy to see happen, and indeed all of our member councils will be happy to see, is following the guidance that best fits for the moment in time that we're in, and making sure that people feel safe in their environment, but also ensuring that children and young people in that environment get the best educational experience. So obviously, we will always be guided, as we have been, by the clinical advice. And as that changes and we can remove certain mitigations, then we will seek to do so. But we would never want to put somebody in a situation where they don't feel safe in being able to access their learning experience and indeed to be working in that space as well. So we will continue to work closely with colleagues to make sure that we update the guidance and people are supported in the best means possible.
I think Margaret Wilson wanted to come in, Oliver Mundell. Margaret Wilson?
Yes, thank you, convener. Yeah, just wanted to make the point that we don't support the continued use of face masks. We would be asking for it to be reviewed on a regular basis. There's obviously not a clear consensus of the use of them with parents. Obviously, again, it's some parents don't want any mitigations in school, whereas some of them want every mitigation in school. So we do represent a wide range in views, but we certainly don't support the continued use of them. But we would obviously want to hear and we have asked for evidence of what you know, why they need to be used. So again, it was in our feedback this week for a COVID-19 recovery group, is when, you know, asking when is it going to be reviewed. That's all we can really do, as the parents' voices, ask, you know, when it's going to be reviewed and regularly.
Thank you for that. I mean, my concern is, you know, we're at a point where almost all of the other you know, regulations and you know, mitigations are starting to be pulled back, but once again, you know, sort of education you know, sort of seems to be at the bottom of the pile. Yet young people have arguably faced the, you know, the sort of biggest disruption so far. You know, do you think that's something, you know, that parents are concerned about? That, you know, the education maybe isn't, you know, we've heard of this in previous question, you know, devices are not getting out to young people. You know, doesn't seem to be, you know, an awful lot being done, you know, on the exam front. You know, it seems to have been left quite late in the year, you know, and now with face masks, you know, we're seeing other restrictions go first and young people asked to continue, you know, with restrictions. Do you think that's a fair, you know, a fair observation?
Well, I think with the face masks, I guess, when it was, when we returned to school in August, you remember that was the time when, not now casting my memory back, 12 to 15 year olds were just allowed to be vaccinated. So it was to, I think it was 6 weeks, and it was to be the initial review. And the explanation that was given at that time, I think most parents understood that schools were quite unique and that there were going to be large numbers of unvaccinated children inside. You know, so I guess parents at that point were very much, okay, we understand the guidance, and, you know, but then it's like with everything with this pandemic, you understand it at that point, and then again, as I said, we've asked for it to be reviewed, which was always assured that it would be, and then of course, just as you're probably about to look at it in a positive light, here comes Omicron. So, and I would have to say I got absolutely no parent emailing me with concerns that that's what they had to do at that time. I think, again, nothing really was known about Omicron. So I guess as I've said, it's like the wide range. You've got some parents that don't want any, you know, and so it is quite hard to sort of know. But I think as long as you get a clear, concise message as why that decision is made, then more parents are more accepting of it. It's just, I think that's what's quite difficult. But yes, I do believe that children are under stricter mitigations than any other area of society. And that is why it's really important that everything is reviewed on a regular basis for the school mitigations, really. Thank you.
No, that's helpful. I don't know if there's any other comment from Greg Dempster, convener, but that would be,
yeah, just I think that there's a couple of things at work here. The first thing is that it was only yesterday that the First Minister announced the changes to take effect from Monday. The CERG group hasn't met since yesterday. It meets tomorrow. So there hasn't been an opportunity to discuss the changes that are expected for the rest of society. And I'm sure that the officials in Scottish Government will be looking at the guidance and to identify any changes that flow from that. And I would imagine there will be quite a few. On top of that, the scientific subgroup that advises the ministers and provides information to the CERG has repeatedly looked again at whether masks are required or face coverings should be required in secondary schools. It's not an area that my membership covers, but I'm party to those discussions at CERG. And their advice up until this point has been to maintain them. So I would imagine they have been asked to look at that advice again as part of their ongoing discussions. And I feel that we should be led by their advice around about that rather than any vocal groups that have a particular view about masks that they have always held, irrespective of the point of the pandemic.
But you would recognise that masks are a barrier to learning? Yeah, and you would want them removed, soon as that advice.
You're saying that I would want that, but I'm assuming that's what you want. But from my perspective, I'm not hearing a great deal from pupil representatives or young people about face coverings being a huge barrier. Yes, they are, of course, a barrier for some individual pupils and in some circumstances or subjects. But the key point is that this has been part of the pandemic response, and it's been a response to advice from the scientific subgroup and others, and I would be keen to hear their advice, which will inform any change to the guidance, not just in relation to face coverings, but in relation to all mitigations that remains.
Thank you for that. You know, and I would just say, you know, my own view is that it is a big ask, and quite uncomfortable to ask young people to sit, you know, at their desk all day in a classroom, you know, with a face covering on, and that's certainly something young people locally raise with me, but I'm probably done in terms of questions, convener.
Thank you, Oliver Mundell, and I turn now to James Dorman. James, have you got any questions that you would like to put as we draw our session to a conclusion?
Thank you, convener, and I will be very short. It's really just in the terrible option of us going back the way where we're having to do more hybrid learning and remote learning in schools. How prepared do panel feel that the schools are? I suppose this is aimed at Greg. How prepared does he feel that schools are for to take that challenge up if it happens again?
Everything that I've heard in relation to the the remote learning provided in the first lockdown versus the second lockdown showed an enormous step change in what was offered in most areas. And I'm sorry, I'm seeing the convener now. Does that mean I have to shut up?
No. She's like a good plan, right enough, but
so it's a definite step change in provision, and that's been reflected, I think, pretty much in every bit of commentary I've seen in relation to that second lockdown period. So if we were to see a horrible situation where we're reverting to that, I think that schools are much better placed than they were previously, much more experienced in engaging in that type of learning and teaching. Hopefully we would see another step of improvement if we did come to that again.
Okay, thanks very much. I suppose just before I finish off then, I just want to welcome Douglas Hutchison to Glasgow. You have a big challenge ahead of you, but I'm sure you're going to be more than capable of it.
Thank you.
Just like to say to Greg that my appearance has never put James Dornan off saying what he wants to say, thankfully. Long may that continue. And I think there was one quick, very quick supplementary from Stephanie just to end our session about the very important issue of the rollout of counsellors for schools. Stephanie, if you'd like to ask that very quickly so that we can end our session.
Thank you, convener, and my congratulations to Douglas too. I didn't do that earlier, and great to know you've got so much background and experience around the ASN stuff. Just going back to mental health a little there, there's been a lot of investment from the Scottish Government, including the £60 million for counsellors across secondary schools. And what I'm hearing is that's really quite patchy. In some areas, it seems to be working. There seems to be great progress. In other areas, not so much there. So it was just to see if you were able to comment on what the challenges are there, and how we might be improving that, whether maybe regional improvement collaboratives are looking at it or whatever. I don't know if this is something that would come under Simon's remit to have a kind of wider view, or if it might more be a question for Douglas.
I have to be very brief. I'm afraid we're really out of time.
I'm happy to comment on it. Thanks, convener. Sorry. It was very much a very targeted budget from Scottish Government with a clear expectation that there would be a councillor for every secondary school. The challenge is clearly getting a councillor, you know, for every secondary school with such a massive expansion in the provision. But my understanding is it was progressing reasonably well, but Scottish Government have more data on it. Certainly, I'm aware that in South Ayrshire there was good provision. There was at least a councillor, at least one in every school. So it was very targeted. It was very specific what the budget was for. It was very clear what the expectation was. The challenge is clearly getting that number of bodies in such a short space of time and ensuring quality councillors with appropriate supervision.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, Stephanie. And can I keep saying thank you? Thank you to Douglas Hutchison, Greg Dempster, Simon Cameron and Margaret Wilson for giving us so much of their time. We've gone quite a bit over time. I apologise for that, but it's been a very useful session. The public part of today's meeting is now at an end. The committee meeting next week will involve an evidence session on the issue of drink and needle spiking. I will now suspend the meeting. Can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams? And that will allow us to consider our final agenda item in private. And again, thank you very much and good morning.